Bismillah wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala ahli wa sahbihi wa ala. In the name of Allah, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions and all those who follow him until the day of judgment. First and foremost, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's peace and blessings be upon you all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for coming on time. Alhamdulillah, I had a little drive, but it's always worth it when you come in to benefit your audience and also to benefit oneself, because the reminder benefits those who believe. So the topic, as it was selected, is fitting in. And as youth, and even as adults, we always, when we go to a new environment, we strive to fit in. We strive to get to know others, and we strive to have people accept us, right? To have people accept the way we talk, the way we dress. So we sometimes modify our dress, modify our phrases, and so on. So I will start, bi'idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with a little story, inshallah. And this is a famous story in Arabic. It's called, it's like a joke. Kind of Juha, right? So one day, maybe you know the story already, inshallah, but it's always good to remember, because we, even though we hear stories and we hear lectures and we hear reminders, we have so many different challenges that we need the reminders again to kind of put us in perspective. So the story is that Juha was riding a donkey. On the side of the donkey was his son walking, holding the reins of the donkey, and the father's riding the donkey. As they're passing by a group, they saw this and they started criticizing them. He said, look at this, the father is riding the donkey and the child is walking. In our modern time, we say this is child abuse, right? Imagine, right now we have cars. Imagine your father or mother drives and you walk on the side of the car, right? They will say, you know, this is an abuse, right? And you will get in big trouble. So the people gathered together and they were saying that, what is this? The father rides and the son walks. So the father overheard this. Juha overheard this. So he got off the donkey and put his son on top of the donkey. And then he walked. He walked on the side of the donkey and his son was riding the donkey. So another group saw this and said, this is wrong. You know, what is this? Typically the young have to honor the adults, right? And now the young is riding and the father is walking. This is wrong. So Juha overheard this again. So Juha overheard this again, and they both, so Juha mounted the donkey, and they both rode the donkey, and they continued, both Juha and his son, riding the donkey, until they came across another group. And this other group said, this is an abuse. Poor donkey. Two people riding the donkey? So they ended up getting off the donkey, and they started walking side by side the donkey. And then another group saw them and said, look at these ridiculous individuals, that they have a donkey and they're not even using it. They have a donkey and they're walking. This doesn't make sense. So the reality is, no matter what we hear, we shouldn't always try to change to please the people. This is the core of the matter. We should strive to please Allah, and everything else comes after. We strive to please Allah, not the donkey. I mean, we're not the people, right? We strive to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from there, you will never go wrong. Whether people like it, they don't like it. We try to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is our key focus. Now, the beauty of this deen is that Allah bless us with the Quran, right? And the Quran teaches us that there is diversity, the diversity of humanity. The diversity of humanity. And many times we look, and even within our community, right? Even within our community. I'm gonna ask questions sometimes, all right? Because I don't wanna only talk. If I ask you a question, I'm not gonna send you an index card. I'll ask you and you just answer, okay? All right, so the question is, have you ever felt judged or looked at different or treated different? And I'm not gonna say in the school, I'm gonna say in the masjid. Right? Have you ever felt that you are not treated as maybe because you're a particular race, of your particular skin color, or you're from a particular tribe? Have you ever felt that you weren't treated as equal? Can anybody raise their hand? Let's see who's the first one who has the courage to raise their hand. Yes. What, give me an example.
Maybe not in the message, but I mean, being raised in the U.S., you always see that somewhere.
Mm.
And then you have to, as you said, you don't care about it. This is who I am. This is what I do.
Mm.
And whether you like it or not, guess what? It's not my problem.
Alhamdulillah. What about you? What about the youth? What about you girls? Have you ever felt that you were discriminated upon, or even if it wasn't to that like height, but that you felt that you know I'm left aside, right? The group is together and I'm by myself. Have you ever felt that? Any of you girls? Just nod your head. You don't have to say anything. Yes? All right. Yes. Okay. This is the reality. We're human beings, right? Now, when we look at these situations, if we look at it from a human being's perspective, we get very upset. And if it happens in the masjid, we lose interest in going to the masjid. Right? We lose interest, and that happens. But now, when we look at it from in the light of the Quran, then it gives us a little bit more wisdom. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that diversity is part of Allah's creation. Different cultures is part of Allah's creation. I was invited to speak in a conference in Canada, and I was asked to speak about Islam versus culture. I changed the subject. I said Islam embraces culture. Right? Isn't it in fiqh? Al-Ada Muhakkama? Right? The cultures and customs are a rule in Islam, of course, if they're within the parameters, but still. So we can't say generally Islam is versus culture, right? So our youth have their own culture as well, right? So now Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha an-nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, waj'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu, inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. O mankind, we made you from a male and a female, and made you into nations and tribes, so that you can know one another. And verily, the most honorable in the sight of Allah is the one who's the most God-conscious. Not the one from this country, that country, not the one that's wearing Armani or Polo or this, but the one who's the most, and there's nothing wrong with that, right? You can wear nice clothes. Inna Allah jamil yuhibbul jamal. Allah is beautiful, He loves beauty. So there's nothing wrong with that, right? As long as you're God conscious, right? As long as you're God conscious. So for example, when we look as youth, when we look at our parents, how many of your parents came from overseas? Raise your hand. If your parents came from overseas. Okay. How many times do you feel that your parents don't understand you and your habits here in America? Just raise your hand if you agree, if that happens to you. that you feel that your parents don't understand you, right? Because you have a different, okay, good. So now your parents, mashallah, they love their country and they left their country and they sacrificed their country, right? And their families just to come and live a better life. That's it. They came, there were maybe political problems back home, war, different types of struggles. So they wanted to get out. Maybe they had children, so they wanted to give their children a better life, right? With more stability. And that's fine. Many got involved in working, even sometimes both parents working full time, and the children will come out of school, and from 3 to 7, the children are unsupervised because the parents are working, right? These things occur. And sometimes, and children, as myself, we don't understand that dad does not have time. He's busy, right? He's busy working. He's busy managing. He just opened a business, right? Opening a business, some people, while managing a business, they get heart attacks, right? Because nobody loves that business like them. Nobody has the vision like them, right? So when they have to try to get workers, there is a trial and error. You know, you have workers that don't, I'm not interested, they just want to get paid, right? So this is the struggle of your parents. The struggle of the youth is that they get their education here. They spend 8 hours a day in school, 5 days a week, that's 40 hours a week. In addition to the extracurricular activity, in addition to going to sports, soccer, or different activities, in addition to coming to the Quran, if you see the numbers of minutes, not hours, the number of minutes a day that a parent spends with his child, minutes, right? So we have our struggles as well. But one thing that I would like to really have you understand, but before I try to make you understand, I would like to ask you first. Where do you consider yourself from? And I want everybody to answer. I'm not gonna wait for you to say me, no, everybody. So I'm gonna start from right to left, because here in America we say ladies first, right? So ladies first. If I ask you, where are you from, sister? Pakistan. Okay, good. Syria, sister? Where? Mali? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restore the condition of our sister in Mali, inshallah. And Mali? MashaAllah. Pakistan? You forgot? Okay, Pakistan? MashaAllah. Okay, now let me ask a question before I go with the boys, right? Because how many of you were born here? Raise your hand. Good. 4 out of 6. Good. Okay, we'll get to you, inshallah. Now from the boys, even starting from you, we're going to put everybody on the spot.
America?
Okay, America. Were you born here?
No.
No. So you were born in?
Pakistan.
Okay, good.
America. Well, I was born in the country, then I was raised in the country. But I've been here twice as much as I have lived in both those countries.
Mm.
So I'm from here, Houston, Texas.
MashaAllah.
I can say I'm American.
MashaAllah.
Here.
Here's not a country, but I'm gonna cut you guys some slack. But I understand, inshallah. U.S. right? Yes.
America.
America. Right. Good. Okay. Good. You just came in, but it's okay. Where are you from? If I ask you, where are you from?
I was born in America.
Where? Like, if you have to give me a number. Good.
Pakistan.
Okay. Good. Now, I'm going to give you something, and this is what I did, and it was like 5,000 people in Canada, right, in the audience, right? And alhamdulillah, there was great speakers alongside as well. I was just, you know, a guest there, honored to be in their presence, with Dr. Ingrid Mattson and Sheikh Nawaid Aziz and others, mashallah. So when I had to, I wanted to set the tone. Now when I describe myself, I say, first my country of origin, right? Because that's God-given. So I am a Puerto Rican, American Muslim. Right? And I'm proud of every one of them. And because I am a Puerto Rican, American Muslim, I have a responsibility to know about my Puerto Rican culture, my American culture, and my Islamic culture. And I have to know my Puerto Rican language, my American language, and the language in which the Quran was revealed, the Arabic language. And I have to be just to each one of them. And we should be proud of each one of them. Right? Now I say, okay, I lived in Egypt, so I'm also Egyptian, right? I only needed one thing. I ate the koshari, tamia, batta, all this. The food was still, that's the only thing that's why they didn't give me my citizenship. But only because of the food. But other than that, alhamdulillah, everything was good. I managed to get the same discounts though. That's the good thing. I used to go to places and they used to try to treat me as a tourist. I said, la, ana akul ta'amuk. أنا أدرس في مدرستك وأنا أسكن هنا وأنا لا أعمل I don't work I live here I work here I eat your food so I'm going to pay your price and they understood right they understood alhamdulillah but the Prophet ﷺ said right whoever learns the language of a people that he becomes of them right so learning when the Prophet ﷺ described Salman al-Farisi Salman the Persian Suhaib al-Rumi, Suhaib the Roman, Bilal al-Habashi, Bilal from Abyssinia, right? There was diversity, new Muslims from different countries that accepted Islam, and they were gathered together. They were gathered together, and one of the people of Medina, the non-Muslim, said, if Muhammad has this tribe, the Aus, right? If Muhammad has this tribe, the Aus, why does he need these people, these poor people? Why does he need them? SubhanAllah. So the Prophet ﷺ heard this. And the Prophet ﷺ called the people to come to the masjid and addressed it. And he said to the Muslim, he said, why do some of you still have traces of the time of ignorance? Right? And he also said another statement, Salman min Ali Bayti, Salman is from my house. Salman the Persian is from my house. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah because of this. In Surah Al-Kahf. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayah that says, and don't look down on them, right? Those that remember Allah, right? Seeking some worldly gain and following those that are misguided. فَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا Don't obey those who are away from the remembrance of Allah and who follow their desires. So Allah revealed an ayah just because of them, because of these poor people, poor new Muslims, right? And who is Bilal, right? Who is Bilal, the one that was a slave, who is? He is one that's known all over the Muslim world, the first mu'adhin, the first to make the adhan. So in Islamic history, he is inscribed in Islamic history, and nobody can remove it from the outset, subhanAllah. So one of the problems that sometimes we have is that internally, And this is, we have to be sincere. Because we could look at the masajid, we could look at administrations, we could look at different situations and find a million excuses to not go to the masjid, right? Or to not go to an event. But it starts with our hearts, right? If inside of our hearts, I look at someone different, if you look at someone different and you look down upon them and you say this one is, oh, this one is, oh, that's just an Hispanic and that's just an African-American, or that's just, you know, and you look down on individuals because of their race, that is the definition of racism. Right? So before we get rid of the racism in society, we have to get rid of it in our hearts. Before we get rid of the racism in our communities, we have to get rid of it in our hearts, as Allah says. Allah does not change the condition of a people until they change that which is within themselves. Right? Even when you see a brother and you disagree with a brother or you don't like a brother, the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Muslim mira'ul Muslim. The Muslim is the mirror of a Muslim. That means if you don't like so-and-so and you criticize so-and-so, you're also criticizing yourself. And that boomerang can come back. So you have to be proud of who you are. So action item is make sure that you preserve your languages. Whether it is whatever language it is from back home, Arabic, you have to learn. This is not optional. Allah revealed the Quran in Arabic, and the words in Arabic are so broad in their meaning and so deep, right? That we should invest in ourselves. And also our language here in English as well. But that comes, if you learn the language, you have to learn the culture. Alhamdulillah. So brothers and sisters, boys and girls, I am a Muslim, and we have to be proud of being Muslims. The first step, I'm going to give you some steps, and we will conclude. Three things. First step is that we have to know Allah. Right? First step is that we have to know who? Allah. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so alhamdulillah, we have time, inshallah. So now, the first step is we have to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and know that Allah comes in between the man and his heart. Know that Allah comes in between the man and his heart. Now if you take your time to know Allah, Allah Ar-Rahman, the compassionate. Ar-Rahim, the merciful. Al-Malik, the ruler, the king. Al-Quddus, the holy, the pure one. As-Salam, the source of peace. Al-Mu'min, the provider of faith. Al-Muhaymin, the guardian, the protector. Al-Aziz, the mighty. Al-Khaliq, the creator. Right? So if you take time to know Allah and reflect on His names, you will get, your iman will increase by the more knowledge you have of your creator. The more knowledge you have of the creator makes you recognize that the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, that if the oceans were ink and the trees were pens to write the words of Allah, the oceans will be exhausted and the words of Allah will never be exhausted. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said that scholars will never be able to penetrate the depths of the Quran. And he's Shaykh al-Islam, master all the disciplines, sciences of Islam. And he says the scholars will not be able to penetrate the depths of the Quran. So number one is to know Allah and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us that He is the creator. He created death and life. Now let me ask you a question. Why did Allah mention in Surah Al-Mulk that He created death and then life? Why didn't He say that He created life and then death? Can anybody tell me? Just think. Yes.
Before life, we were dead.
Okay. Before life, we were dead. Right.
This is the main truth that everybody will have.
Good. Good. That is the main truth. Anybody else?
Death is life.
Good. Death is life. So here, in the tafsir, it says that the reason why Allah mentions death first is because we're so preoccupied with life that we need to be reminded of death. Again, when Allah says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ. He is the one that created death and life to test you. To test you to see which of you are best in deeds. So know that life is a test. Know that life is a test. So first know Allah, know that this life is a test, and that any hardship that you encounter is a sign of the love of Allah. Those that have been tested the most, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, were the Anbiya, and then the most righteous. Those were the ones tested the most. And the Messenger of Allah said, strange is the affair of the believers. And it is only for the believers. If good comes to him, he is grateful to Allah. He is thankful, and this is good for him. And if he encounters some hardship, he is patient, and it is good for him. And this is for no other than the believer. So the believer always turns every situation into a positive one. That's the believer. The believer always turns the positive, the negative into a positive. So step one, know Allah and know that this life is a test. Step two, know your prophet. Know the Messenger of Allah. Because once you believe in Allah, you are required to act upon what Allah wants you to act upon. And by knowing the Messenger of Allah, you try to follow his footsteps. And if you really love Allah, and you have to follow the Messenger of Allah. And if you follow the Messenger of Allah, as Aisha radiallahu anha said, the character of the Messenger of Allah, ka Quran yamshi ala al-ard, it is like a Quran walking upon the earth. His life was the Quran. And Allah describes him as the best of character, as a mercy to the world. The Messenger of Allah said what? And this, when you look at this hadith, and you look at the tragedies that are occurring worldwide, sometimes in the name of Islam, and you look at the teachings of Islam, it does not coincide. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Ar-Rahimuna, please pay attention. Because this that I'm relating is not, I'm relating something from the Messenger of Allah. الرَّاحِمُونَ يَرْحَمُهُمُ الرَّحْمَنُ. The merciful will be shown mercy by the most merciful. The merciful will be shown mercy by the most merciful. Again, the merciful will be shown mercy by the most merciful. Irhamu man fil ard, have mercy on those that are upon the earth. Yarhamukum man fis sama, that the one who's in the heavens will have mercy on you. So it's mercy for all. That is what our Prophet taught us. Mercy for all. And last but not least, so knowing Allah, knowing that this life is a test, knowing your messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and three, the most reliable friend. When you look for a friend, he has to be trustworthy. He has to be. And I was shocked. I was shocked that my friends, I was with them Sunday, and on Monday I see on the news that 11 individuals that I knew killed them, stepped on their faces, and they were actually from the same gang, from the same group. These friends typically will encourage you to smoke cigarettes. We'll give it to you for free. We'll give you alcohol for free. We'll give you drugs for free. And then when you get addicted and you want it, then you have to pay for it. Then you have to pay for the cigarettes. Then you have to pay for the alcohol. Then you have to pay. Then you become enslaved to that. So when I lost trust in all my friends, I remember that one of my friends wanted to read the Quran. So I'm going to say this. This is between me and you guys, inshallah. And the rest of people on YouTube that see, inshallah. My friend wanted the Quran, so I stole it for him. So my first Quran wasn't a pocket-sized Quran, but it was the big Abdullah Yusuf Ali with the commentary. So somebody asked the next question, like, how can you steal this big Quran? I said, if I can steal Timberlands, I can steal Quran. It's not piece of cake. But I stole it from my friend. This Quran was left in my house. When my friends got killed and I lost trust in everyone, I began to go to different churches and I got 6 Bibles. And then I opened the Quran. And for 9 months, the Quran became my best friend. I would walk in the streets with this big Quran and not be ashamed of it. If the Quran will tell me, إِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ فَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا, reading Quran in Fajr is witness. So I began to wake up in the middle of the night. Imagine my mom, my dad. My mom used to be a nun too, before she married my dad, right? So they're all sleeping, and I am waking up in the middle of the night in secret. I wanted to do it between me and Allah. So I turn on a little dim light, and I begin to read Quran for like 1 hour. And then I will make sujood, and then I will go to sleep. I would hear my parents wake up, my father's getting ready to go to work, and I would say to myself in bed, they're just waking up. I already achieved something. And because I was doing it in secret, it increased my iman. It gave me strength. So mind you that I said that I became addicted to cigarettes and alcohol. And I was very impatient. What tamed me, what made me calm, was befriending the Quran. The Quran said, "Kutiba alaykum as-siyam." So I began to fast. But I wasn't as lucky as you, right? I didn't know Maghrib existed, right? You know how it feels in Maghrib, if you're fasting. I didn't know Maghrib existed. So I would fast until Isha, late, because I wanted to feel what the poor people felt. I said, Analisa Munafik, I'm not a hypocrite. I know that I have food in my refrigerator. I know that I have drinks and juice and all this in my refrigerator. I want to fast until I feel pain, until I feel the pain that the poor people feel. When I feel that pain and I can't tolerate it anymore, then I will eat. And I wasn't Muslim. So I began to practice the Quran. I had a loose tongue, right? So in every sentence, I used to sing Spanish rap, right? You know, Daddy Yankee and Don Omar. Those cats are new jacks on the block. Before they became famous in the U.S., Spanish rap in Puerto Rico was underground. It was illegal. And I used to sing rap in New York. So I had a music contract, and I left it because I was searching for the truth and I didn't want to be in that environment. So now I read in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تَقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. All you who believe, fear Allah and only say that which is right. So I began to control my tongue. And I stopped talking unnecessarily, right? I'm here with my friends hanging out by the school, and I'm quiet. And my friends are asking me, my non-Muslim friends, right? I was not Muslim too. They said, why are you not talking, man? What's wrong with you? I said, there's no need to talk. Why am I gonna waste words if I'm gonna be accountable for that? Instead of talking, I would rather have someone talk to me. Who's this? I said, God in the Quran. So I'm gonna go read the Quran. So I'm in the corner with all my friends, and they're smoking cigarettes, smoking weed, hanging out, some with their girlfriends, and I chose to take the Quran and sit in my car and just read Quran. Now, it took me 9 months until I felt that I believe in everything that is in the Quran. And I said, now I gotta go to the masjid. So I went to the masjid, alhamdulillah, and I accepted Islam. Then when I would come, and alhamdulillah, the Quran helped me leave cigarettes, alcohol, and made me more patient, right? 2 years later, I kept, you know, daily after Fajr, I would come to my house and my mother would be in the kitchen, right? And I began to share with her some Quran. Mom, can I share with you something? She was a nun, right? So she loves Mary and Isa alayhi salam. So I said, Mom, can I share with you something? It's about Mary. There's a chapter in the Quran called Mary. So we will read, and subhanAllah, I got married and I moved out. Later on, my mom says, you know, I miss your reading of the Quran. I said, really? Why? She said, because it answered all the questions that I had that made me leave the convent. And I said, what does that mean? Do you believe in what you heard? She said, yes. So then I said, why don't you perfect your faith? Right? Because the people of the book, they have some traces of the truth. Not everything is batil, right? It comes from the same source. But the Quran was preserved. So I'm just saying, why don't you perfect your faith? And it's very easy. She said, how do you do it? Just say two sentences. So in 2002, my mother accepted Islam, alhamdulillah. 4 months later, my dad accepted Islam. 2 years later, my older brother accepted Islam. And in that same month, I was blessed, alhamdulillah, with a scholarship to go study in Egypt because I wanted to learn the Arabic language to understand the Quran in Arabic and not be at the mercy of a translator. Because I wanted to experience Allah talking to me in the language that He revealed the Quran. I wanted to experience understanding what the imam is reading in Taraweeh. I wanted to cry behind the imam by understanding Allah talking to me. And alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with this ni'mah, and this is a favor of Allah upon me. It's not a favor, my accepting Islam and whatever I gained is not a favor upon Islam, but it's actually a favor upon me. So alhamdulillah, so fitting in, brothers and sisters, know Allah first, foundation, know Allah, read a biography of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and befriend the Quran. And from there, you start looking at things different. Barakallahu feekum. So we have 5 minutes, it's 12:10, according to the solar time, right? So if there's any questions, please feel free to ask, inshallah. Or pass them forward. Any questions, or you can say them loud, or you can pass them forward.
No questions from this side.
No questions, brothers? You can ask it if you want. You can ask it. What is it? You want to write it? You can write it, inshallah. Fadal Habib, you can write it. Very good question. So is there an ayah in the Quran that says that you have to know the language of where you live in, or is it in a hadith? It's not. I mean, in the ayah that I mentioned, right, that he made you qabail, right? لِتَعَارَفُ, that he made you tribes and nations, right, to know each other. How are you going to know each other? How are you going to know other people if you don't know yourself? We have to know ourselves. And that is, if Allah made you from a particular country, is that a sin? It's from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that divinely decrees where we're going to be born from. Sometimes when we become Muslim, we go through phases. If we go to an Arab masjid, we become Arab. If we go to a Pakistani masjid, we become Pakistani. And then years down the line, we lose hope in that masjid, right? And so on. So we have to learn about ourselves and be proud of this and glorify Allah. Glorify Allah for this and learn about your culture. If you know about this, then you will be able to distinguish, for example, what Islam says and what is your culture. And what is acceptable in Islam and what is not acceptable in Islam. But if we do not know, we don't know the difference. So we mix Islam with culture, we become confused, and then as we learn, we see somebody else saying, that's not Islam. Wait a minute, but I learned it in my country. But there is things that we have to learn. So I will recommend starting with these 3 points. Allah, knowing about Allah, knowing about His Messenger, and knowing about the Quran. Jay. My strength in Islam is weak. And how can I make it strong? I will say, start by doing things in secret. Right? Read a little bit of Quran and try to do, if you have, let's say you have an extra dollar, you try to, in secret, you put it in the donation box, right? Or you reserve it and you see a poor person and you give it to them, whether they need it or not. But what I'm saying is, try to do things in secret, your iman will increase. If you can wake up in the middle of the night or an hour before Fajr, we have a lot of smartphones and tablets, put your alarm, right? And wake up, even 30 minutes. And in that time, pray to make wudu, pray to rakats, and make dua. Ask Allah. The Prophet ﷺ, I will give you this in English, right? there's a dua that the Prophet ﷺ used to make in the last rak'ah of every salah. Alright? O you who controls the heart, make our hearts firm in your deen. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O you who controls the visions, controls the heart, make our hearts firm in your deen. Why? Because the heart, yuqallib, the heart changes. So today you have strong faith, tomorrow you have weak faith. Right? So it's Ya muqallib al-qulub wal-absar, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O you who controls the visions and the heart, make our hearts firm in your deen. Okay? O you who controls the visions and the heart, make our hearts firm in your deen. So the Prophet ﷺ used to make this institute, and he is Rasulullah. He is Rasulullah. Any other questions, inshallah? You can say them loud and we'll conclude because time's up, inshallah. Any other questions? Any other questions? Barakallahu feekum, subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum as-salamu alaykum.